I will remain comforted. I'm fellowship with each other. And in 2 weeks. 2 weeks from tonight? Is that Saturday after Thanksgiving? Yes. My daddy's going to be here. He's going to bring the word of God. And it's going to be powerful and anointed, and I just can't wait. I should say, he's my favorite preacher. I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry, but he's not. But you're my favorite husband. You're my favorite man. I did. I saved that one, didn't I? All right. I'm ready to preach.
I think he's probably not a good preacher, too. He's fantastic. Just a wonderful man of God. Been doing that ministry for
60 years. 60 years.
60 years.
No. More than that.
60 years. At age 16, moved from Georgia to the inner city of Detroit and started a church that is still there today. And he used to play the drums so he's a blessing. He and his wife, my mother-in-law, they have just fully recovered from
praise
COVID.
God.
And are healthy
God.
And strong at 77 and 77, somewhere around 77, right? So praise the Lord. He is the healer. He answers our prayers. When we pray and believe, there's a shifting. There's a turning in our favor as we pray, as we believe God for his power. And, I was thinking as we were singing that song, Jesus said he's come to declare the year of the Lord's favor, to set captives free, to open up blind eyes. And it may not feel like the year of the Lord's favor, but we are living in God's favor. And it's not all about physical. For us, it seems to always be about physical comfort. But for him, it's about spiritual, that he has brought salvation to us. And he has brought the favor of God back to his children. Thank God. Amen. I just love the best part of the crucifixion reference in the Word of God to me is when the veil was rent in the temple, torn right down, indicating that we now are once again fully restored in our relationship with God. And that's what it's all about. That's what it's all about. That's the reason we're still here, is to continue in our salvation and experience the favor of God. And I early this week felt to talk about this, and really, I've just been praying all week since then that the Lord would just give me the right words to say, because we are living in a time when we are in a dry and weary land, right? As the deer pants for the water, so our souls are hungry and thirsty for that Holy Spirit presence that changes the atmosphere, that turns the darkness to light. Aren't you desperate for that? Like I'm saying, I'm desperate for you. And we too often try to work those things out in our own abilities and our own strength, and the Lord doesn't want that. He wants to provide every need according to his riches and glory. But we have to run to him. We have to go and seek, go and knock, go and just seek his presence and his answer to every situation. Lean not unto your own understanding, but in all of your ways acknowledge him. And I have a fight all day long with my own understanding and my coming to him and acknowledging him in all of my ways. And, the enemy just comes to you and just says, he's busy. He's busy somewhere else. Look at all the other things he's got to worry about that you just need to figure this out. Right? And the enemy tries to take our eyes off the fact that God has numbered the hairs on our head. It's easy for me. It's easy for Brother Burgess. So I got the words guards and shields. You know, we were talking even last week, we were talking again tonight, about the armor of God and how important it is for us to recognize that we are not fighting a flesh and blood battle. The Bible is clear that we're not fighting a flesh and blood battle. We are fighting a spiritual battle. There is an enemy that is seeking the enemy isn't as concerned about our physical demise. He is after our spiritual demise. And that spiritual warfare requires us to have shields and guards and armor all the time.
Amen.
And make sure that we are facing this battle, this spiritual battle, with the armor of God. Now, Philippians chapter 4. We talk, I think I've probably read this maybe every day in 2020 because it's an important verse. And you probably could quote it with me, but it's from Philippians chapter 4, beginning with verse 4. Rejoice in the Lord always. And he decided, I gotta say it again. Rejoice. Sometimes, a lot of times, there's very little for us to look at and say, I can rejoice in this experience. I can rejoice in this circumstance. It doesn't say to rejoice in the circumstance. It doesn't encourage us to rejoice in what we see. No, it's rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. This I love. The Lord is near. The Lord is near. Sometimes we don't feel him. Sometimes we don't feel that presence. But the Word of God says he is an ever-present help. He sticks closer than a brother. You don't have to understand it or you don't have to feel it. You just need to know it. He is near. Verse 6, do not be anxious about anything. Oh my goodness, is that not the daily battle? Is that not the daily battle? But the thing that we have to recognize is the battle is between the anxiety over whether God cares for us and the truth that he is near. And he is an ever-present help in time of trouble. Do not be anxious about anything. But what? But in everything, by prayer and petition. Now this is important. With thanksgiving. With thanksgiving. By prayer and petition. We don't need to be anxious, but we come to the Lord with thanksgiving. Too many times our prayer request is just a list of complaints.
Right.
You know? It's just a list of complaining. And the Lord never says that he blesses complaints. In fact, he doesn't bless complaints. When the children of Israel started complaining in the wilderness, the Lord just delivered them miraculously from Egypt. They start complaining, well, what are we going to do now? What are we going to eat? What are we going to do? And the Lord says, I'm tired of your complaining.
Yes.
Right? And what happened when the complainers complained? They got stuck in their wilderness for 40 years. The Lord didn't move them forward because they were trusting that the God who just delivered them was going to take them all away. They started complaining about their situation. So in everything, by prayer, petition, with thanksgiving, man, we need to wake up every morning and count our blessings.
Thank you.
Name them one by one.
Amen.
And there are, you'd be a busy person if you just started really naming them.
Amen.
One by one.
Amen.
Too many times I wake up and I count my struggle. I count my problems. But the Bible says, count your blessings. Don't forget the benefits that the Lord gives. I just thank God I'm living another day. I wake up in the morning and I'm alive. There's one. Number two, got a great family, got a great wife, got a great son. My son came and bleached this place yesterday, so we could all be safe today. He did it all. I just sat back and waited for the floor to dry. So I thank God for that. I thank God for the ability we have in these trying times to be able to come together like this and to be able to be in church together. I thank God that I have food to eat and clothes to wear. Too much food to eat. And
didn't bring anything for me, but I'm thankful anyway. I'm thankful anyway. You're going to help Renee with her whatever you need help with. I don't know. I'm thankful for you.
Just stop.
I'm thankful for her face with or without me.
Yes, right.
I am thankful. Thankful that I have a great place to live. It may not be much. It may not be a mansion, but it's fine. I get to get up in the morning and look out the window and not see snow and wilderness. I see beauty and flowers. We have so much to be thankful for. Remind yourself to be thankful. With thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, this is the answer to not having anxiety and to being thankful. The peace of God which transcends understanding. It's not something we're going to have in ourselves. It's not something we can think and determine we're going to have. It transcends understanding. And look what it does. It will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
Isn't that the important part of the casting our cares upon Him and trusting Him? Because don't we need that peace to guard our hearts and our minds? I've been looking at this for months, this connection between our thinking and our heart. And out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. And sometimes you can even change the heart by changing the way you speak.
Amen.
So the peace of God guards our hearts and our minds. That's the guard that I'm talking about tonight. Isaiah chapter 26, starting in verse 1, it says, "We have a strong city. God makes salvation its walls and ramparts. Open the gates that the righteous nation may enter, the nation that keeps faith. You will keep in perfect peace, whose mind is steadfast because he trusts in you. Trust in the Lord forever, for the Lord is the rock eternal." Now, this peace is not only about our circumstances, but our peace with God and our perpetuating the peace with God with other people. Remember, it's most important to God that we have that relationship, that we've accepted salvation, and that peace with Him allows us to have peace in our hearts and in our minds. And what the Bible says, that the strong city is salvation. The walls that guard us are salvation. And so keep in mind, the enemy is trying to steal your salvation and steal that peace that you have with God by you turning your faith to other things and not back to faith with God. Peace is a fruit of the Spirit, isn't it? Love, joy, peace. Fruit, I've learned, is exhibited. We exhibit the fruit of the Spirit, right? It's not just something that is within us. The Bible says that by their fruit, you will know them. Well, how do you know fruit unless you can see it, unless you can see evidence of that? So peace is exhibited in our lives. It is encouraged. Love, it's something people can see. It is exhibitable. Jesus said, "Blessed are the peacemakers," which means it's something that can be made by us, that we can have this peace that we can actually perpetuate and make in our lives with salvation and in the lives of others. Peace with God and salvation is the only way we can experience the perfect peace that guards our heart. And with other people in our society, they will never be at peace until they're at peace with God.
That's right. That's right.
That when Jesus said, "I have come to be the Prince of Peace," peace, and the song says, "Peace on the earth, goodwill toward men," it's about the Lord's favor, not about our getting along with each other, but our getting along with Him and being in the right place for Him. Amen? So, the shield then, Psalm chapter 3, beginning with verse 1, in the NIV is, I'll sing it for you later. So you oh Lord, how many are my foes? How many are my foes? How many rise up against me? Many are saying of me, God will not deliver him. Mm-hmm. Now, they're probably talking about a physical enemy, but we are dealing with a spiritual enemy that comes and says, God's not going to deliver you. It's really as simple as Jesus coming and dying on the cross, and that pays the price of the sins of the world. It can't be that simple. It can't be that easy. It's got to be something more. You got to be able to do more. And he gets us trapped in our works, and he tells us, God will not deliver. God will not deliver us from our problems. God will not provide for our needs. That's our foe. That's our enemy that rises up against me. And verse 3, it says, but you are a shield around me. But thou, O Lord, are a shield for me. My glory and deliverer. See, you didn't know it. Of my head. Now, he's a shield around me. He bestows glory on me and lifts my head. I love that line because what I think of with the lifting of our head is the shame that someone feels. You know when a child is ashamed or knows he's been naughty or whatever, he bows his head. And our loving Heavenly Father lifts our head, takes away that shame, and he bestows his glory. That's the shield around us. To the Lord I cry aloud, and he answers me from his holy hill. I love this. I lie down and sleep. I wake again because the Lord sustains me. Psalm chapter 33, verse 20. We wait and hope for the Lord. He is our help and our shield. In him our hearts rejoice, for we trust in his holy name. Proverbs 18, 10 and 11. I'm going to start with 11. It says, the wealth of the rich is their fortified city. The wealth of the rich is their fortified city. They imagine it as an unscalable wall. Isn't that true? People that put so much emphasis on making sure we acquire riches as if that's not able to go away tomorrow. But the verse 10, it says, the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous with salvation run to it and are safe. Right? It's in the salvation of God that we run to it, we wrap ourselves around it. It's a strong tower, a fortified tower. Ephesians chapter 6. You know this? Take up the shield of faith. The shield of faith. Again, it's the knowledge and the faith that God has saved us, that God can keep us, that God can deliver us. That's our shield. And what is that shield, the purpose of it in Ephesians? With which you can extinguish all of the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take up that shield. Take up that shield of faith. Knowing God is in control. Knowing God is worthy of praise. And he's going to take care of our salvation and our every need. That shield of faith. And I love the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. If you are not staying in the Word of God, you are not receiving that life blood that we need to live every day. 1 Peter chapter 1, beginning with verse 3, says, praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade, kept in heaven for you. You have an inheritance because of Jesus, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. And this action in your life.